A very fine morning to all. Good morning, guys. Yes, hope you're all loaded with good energy for the first session of today. So I'm going to here deal with WebXR, which is also called as mixed reality or extended reality. So the words augmented and virtual reality became very buzzing in the recent days. Anyone can guess why? So previously we had keypad phones. I mean, I still do use it. And then we have touchscreen. Then came the smartphones, and still the revolution is going on. Now, what is the next thing after smartphone? What are we going to have is as in a technology after smartphone? How is the era of revolution going to be, was a question among people. So that is how we thought there could be experiences made something different and given to the people. And that is how we landed up in virtual and augmented reality. And now the further advancements became into mixed reality. So I guess most of you would have seen in the malls or any of the PlayStation areas where there will be a big, huge goggles and you wear it around and you see so many 360 degree kind of views and also get an immersive effect into it. So all of you have a basic knowledge about what is VR and AR. So today I will help you out with how far VR and AR is also easy to develop, and from a developer's point of view, how it can be put it into the real world environment and what can be the real use cases. It is not just for environment, but it is to create an even more meaningful and greater impact. That is why I chose my passion to do something in augmented and virtual reality, and my company also does applications on the same. So a little about me. So that was a good introduction, in fact. So in terms of Mozilla, I'm a Mozillian rep, where I got a greater duty to propel about any of the Mozilla's initiative to the public. And also I evangelize mainly on mixed reality. And also there is a program called Open Leaders in Mozilla. So I'm part of the cohort 7 now. And I'm right now a trainee in it. So down you can see the logos of A-Frame. That is what I'm going to talk about today. And on the other end, you can see some good bees there. So that's called LUMOS. It's called Women in Mozilla. And I'm in fact grateful for FOSSMeet for having considered to have at least one woman speaker. When I saw Amarjit's speech the first day, I saw there was a good reputation of women speakers from the start of FOSSMeet. I hope it doesn't gradually get down in the later coming days. And down you can see the other, the one on the left is the campus clubs. So there are campus clubs initiatives being taken in many areas, especially colleges, and I just guide them through it. So Sheldon Cooper fans in the crowd. Great, but that wasn't supposed to be my question. So how many know what is VR in first place? Virtual reality. Nice. So today you're going to see something more different than what is virtual reality. So as you all know, the basic definition for virtual reality is about immersing yourself into a virtual environment. So you get to access virtual objects in a virtual environment is a basic simple form that we give for this phrase called virtual reality. Next, web AR. It is augmented reality. So augmented reality, how many of you had played Pokemon Go? Yes. So did you realize the fact that it was working under augmented reality-based technologies? All right. So augmented reality is to interact with a real-world object. So once you scan the real world, you can actually place some virtual objects and, in fact, interact with them. So that's how augmented reality is so fascinating about. So the next trend, now VR came and even AR is being defined. Now what is the next thing? It is about creating feel among the users. It is about creating a new revolution among the users. That is why it was being thought that the next level of progression should be taken to extended reality or mixed reality. That is what, if you had heard about Magic Leap and Microsoft HoloLens, everyone is now going towards something called extended reality or mixed reality. So the X actually means that it can be VR, AR, or MR. So in the place of X, whatever the next revolution is going to occur, that will be replaced in the place of X. Or in other terms, it is also called extended reality, where you immerse VR and AR experiences into a particular headset or a particular gadget. So that is how XR is evolving. Okay, so on the slide, there's a big fan of web, right? He's a lover of web. So if you had seen, there were good prefixes of web, VR, AR, and XR. If you had been wondering what is that web, it is just nothing that we are going to create through A-Frame many web applications which can support virtual, augmented reality, and even extended reality. And this just needs, you know, you to generate a small link and you tap it anywhere on any browser, it just works. So it doesn't require you to insert into a gadget or to use a special gadget. You just have to open it on your mobile phone, and if you really want the immersive feel, then you can go for the extra gadgets. Otherwise, it is just simple as that. So A-Frame. A-Frame is one of the beautiful framework being created by Mozilla, and this framework actually started to make common people realize that this is how VR works. This is how augmented reality works. Because many application, native application development or SDKs which are available only for the Vive or HoloLens became very costly because the gadgets were very costly to purchase. But this made every common man realize, okay, this is how I can experience VR. This is how I can experience augmented reality and what it is about. So the knowledge of VR and AR to many people started to spread just because of A-Frame. So as I said before, the devices that you can use to get the immersive feel, the one on the top is mainly focused on VR, and down you can see the mobile phone. So the mobile phone where you had played Pokemon Go and stuff. So the next thing that is going to be for augmented reality or even mixed reality is going to come within a small device that can be even the size of this kind of a spectacle. So it becomes easier for you. The very reason is, just think when you're taking a car for a ride and you don't know the way, so you use now a Google map. So you would have faced a lot of hurdles, looking at the phone and again seeing to the road, and that becomes very, tiresome, right? So that is why now it is all going to become in just a small lens, and where you can just immerse it with the real world and just keep driving along all the way with all the guidelines. So this, when you compare it with the native apps, so what are the main struggles that you actually face while downloading an app? Mostly it would be the license versions that you have to download, or it could be unnecessary acceptance of any kind of risk or anything of that sort. So that is why you have a gatekeeper. Then the next is the installation problem. It takes loads and loads of time to install a virtual reality app, because VR apps are mainly made of 3D assets. So these becomes very tedious for anyone to install in their mobile phone, and it consumes a lot of memory. And the last one is a closed door. It means that most of the time, when you try to install an app of VR, it doesn't synchronize with the device that you're using externally. So if you don't move the other way, if you even try to move the other way, the VR scene may not actually move. So that is why it is being closed from the experiences, what you actually have to experience while you wear the VR gadget. So the just the opposite of all that which I said, you have it as an advantage in A-frame. So this is going to be very instant because it is just going to be on a tap of a link that you get to experience. And it is also free. Anyone can contribute in A-frame. You can make your own components the way you want it to be, the way you want to experience it to be. You can just do it yourself. And it's that easy. So the last thing is that it is always going to be, you know, keeping you within the live space. That is, I'll tell you what is it behind so that it supports the gadget also. Yeah, so it is WebGL. So most of the browsers today, if you have been updated to the latest version of browsers, they all support WebGL. So it is because of the WebGL support that, you know, A-frame can help you in synchronizing very clearly with the gadget. For, say if I'm using a Google Cardboard and I insert my phone into it, and if I try to move around, you can see that you're moving along with the virtual space and there can be no difference or fluctuation between it. So that is why we recommend A-frame as a good framework to start with. So there are various other scripts or JS stuff that is very helpful for doing this WebVR or WebXR in fact. But this is the amount of lines that will take to do a small application if you take, for instance, 3.js. So this is the amount of lines that you have to do a small hello world or some basic kind of stuff. Now, in the case of A-frame, just count how many lines are there. It will not exceed even 15. So this is how it helps. A-frame has been, in fact, been derived from 3.js and other support. But again, this just crunches it down to make you give you the exact kind of feel that you can actually develop with the actual 3.js also. Yes. So this is the, if you can see, this is the small hello world program that we usually do in A-frame. So this contains, if you can see, there are four components, and also it is being wrapped into an environment called Sky. So the Sky is a wrapping layer which gives a 360 degree feel, and that defines, you know, it's just like how the real world sky is like. You're being surrounded with the sky, right? So that's how in VR also. And you can see the components are very explicit there, like a box gives you a cube and cylinder gives you the 3D model there. So it's very explicit and very easy to use. So if you know much about JS, then you should be figuring out what are these logos actually represent. So if you're trying to do a VR-based application using any of this, and A-frame, if you want to import the features of A-frame, it definitely supports that and makes your work very easy. The basic system which is being followed in A-frame is the entity component-based system, which means, say for instance, there is a ball here, and I tell that as my component. So a sphere is my ball. And if I'm going to add a feature to it, like a bouncing ball, or if I'm going to give a feature, like a color to it, then it becomes an entity component based system. So that is how you define every entity. Why we say entity component based system is because there are very few predefined components which are already there in the registry. If you want to make your own component, if you want to define your own objects, then you can definitely go to the exact component and make the changes that you want in A entity and bring it back to the way you want it to be. So that is how you customize everything the way you want it. That is why a knowledge about entity component is very mandatory about when you go for A-frame. So these are a few components The ones in the red are the most usual used ones when you develop a basic A-frame application. And the others on the blue are, you know, like, if it depends on the necessity. If you want it, you may use it. And rather than this, if you want to make your own, then there is this thing called registry. You can go to the registry where the pre-existing A-frame components are there. You can create one, or you can choose one and make the changes that you want, and also contribute back to the same, so that if anyone else would like to use the component that you had created, it will be open. The very interesting part about A-frame is the inspector. So when you have the application in a running state, just on the runtime, if you just click on Control Alt I, where the inspector opens, and you can see the values there. So either if you want to change the position, or if you want to change the rotation or the scale, you can just make the changes and view the changes on the runtime itself. So it becomes very easy when you develop. So most of which I've covered here, or which I told here to you, you can refer in aframe.io for you know, more extended details. There are documents and updates on versions that A-frame is working on, so you can keep a track of it. So one of the best use case of WebVR is in medicine. So mostly, when I was in my college, we were also trying to do a small medical project for the students of the medical college. So they, in the first year, didn't like to go to the anatomy classes because of the you know, strange smell that is coming out of the cadaver and all. So we thought if it is being delivered in VR, it becomes more easier for them, more, you know, easy for them to even access, and mostly the cadavers are dead, right? So they don't even know how a live body actually works. So when it is being transformed into VR, you get to feel every experience in a more detailed way. So it's the best use case of VR. And in AR, for now, AR.js is going good with object tracking. And for the other use cases, it is coming, it is into development stage. For now, tracking.js and stuff is being used for other purposes of AR. But for now, AR.js is going good with the hero marking recognition. So I can show you some few demos. Depending on how much time I have. Yeah. So this is Glitch. For those who do not know, it is very useful in you know, just importing your HTML or CSS or JS file and just take a live demo of it. It is very easy. Like in, it is more than an editor, in fact. So this is one of the basic, you know, project which has been done for making your own experience of a planetarium kind of feel. So you can see the planets around, and these are basically nothing but A-spheres. So A-spheres being used to, you know, align them in various spaces. And as you can see, you should basically have some knowledge of what is X, Y, and Z axis, and how in VR space it will work. So mostly there comes a confusion of where this Z axis works. So actually these belong to the Cartesian axis. So Z in VR is actually towards the screen. So you should always look into it if the Z axis is being aligned with the pace that it is going towards the screen, so that you get the right, you know, when you actually try to zoom into that particular object, whether does it happen or not. So this is the basic code for making the planetarium thing, and probably I will share you all the links so that you can try yourself at home. So the next version of this is And if you had been wondering in the previous experiment, how did those rings come to, like wrapping it over the particular sphere, it is nothing but there is a very easy thing called torus knot. And the torus knot is very useful in create, if you can see the primitive is torus in the IC ring, if you can see, the primitive will be defined as torus. So torus knot, we usually say it as torus knot because that helps in actually wrapping a particular component within the space. So I had another basic one. Yeah, so if you can see in this, it's kind of different from the previous one. So can you find the difference from the basic module? So this has an animation, like moving animation. And in the same way, you can see some textures being wrapped around it. So these are the extra features that you get on an A-frame. And you can see on the right bottom corner that there is a VR mode. So when you insert, I mean, when you open the particular link on any of your browser, it can be Chrome or Firefox or anything of the sort. And if you get into the VR mode, basically the screen splits into two, and it gives you, you can actually move it with your fingers, but if you have a good cardboard, Google Cardboard, or any VR-based external, you know, any of the devices, then that gives you a lot of immersive feel. Okay, this is the other, revolution or the next step being taken by Mozilla. So it's called hubs.mozilla.com. This is very interesting to create virtual conferences, and it has many, you know, spaces. For instance, like a small building or a conference room or a house or a small plane. So there are many chat rooms. So you create a chat room and you can name the chat room, or it by default gives you a good cool name. And if you want to contribute into hubs, you should be well versed in 3.js because right now it is being developed with 3.js support. Maybe in future, A-frame might support it. But for now, if you would like to do, we actually use Spoke. So Spoke actually helps in creating any of the 3D assets that you want it to be, or the 3D environment that you want to create. And if you create a cool chat room, then it will be displayed in Hub's website, and anyone can use the chat room. So I'll just give an invite. Yeah, if you all have a mobile phone, can you type the link up there? hub.link/0Capital P S capital Z V V capital S. Is it visible? Yeah. And try to give enter on screen. It will just ask you basic permissions. You can just do that. Yeah, so let me find how many of you are there. You can actually create your own avatar also. It will ask you for options the way you want to you want to look like. I find many of you joined, but I couldn't see any of you. Yeah, there's someone here. Who's that? Anyway, looking cool. Can you come to the lobby? Is anyone outside wandering about? Okay, there. Cool stuff that you can also see in this. So you can take a selfie even if you want. There's a camera there, and you can just capture. An image of yourself there. So I'm right now having the camera the other side, so I guess it's captured. So I just hit on my spacebar and it captures the image. Yeah, so I took a pretty picture of Whistler. Yeah. So other options, like a drawing pen, if you want to just draw something or paint something over there, you can use it. And if you want, even you can insert any of the image or even media files that you want to display to the whole chat room, or even you can do a small slideshow if you want. So that's how a virtual space is useful and very interactive too. All right, so these are the few links that you can refer for contributing, or even there are good documents there which tells about the updates and the forthcoming projects of Mozilla's mixed reality in terms of even VR and AR. And so these are the few social links that you can follow up for the immediate updates, or if you want to even get in touch with one of the Mozillian staff, so they can help you or guide you if you feel, then you can, you are welcome to do that. These are my links. If you want to get in touch with me and if you would like to know more about VR and AR experiences, or if you tried out something and if you have a doubt, you're very welcome to do. Yeah, so we've come to the end, and hope you all enjoyed the VR experiences. So thanks for being very silent and patient audience. Thank you very much.
Okay, moving on to the question and answer session. Anyone?
Can you just distinguish between mixed reality, augmented reality, and virtual reality? I'm not sure if I missed it while I was out.
No problem. There were many who were out, so they joined. All right. So virtual reality, as I said, is going to be an immersive feel. So you, once you wear the particular gadget, you're going to extremely get into that environment, and you can access only those objects within that virtual environment. Now, when it comes to augmented reality, in the real world, you can project out the virtual objects and interact with them, and you can feel that they are just on the real world. Like if you had played Pokemon Go, it would have been interactive with the real world. So that is virtual. That is augmented reality. Now coming to mixed reality, it is a combination of both, interacting with the real world environment and also giving you a virtual experience. So you get a 360 degree feel of being in that particular place, and also you get an access with the virtual objects which are very much syncing with the real world. Augmented and so. No, mixed reality you cannot compare, because mixed reality involves virtual and augmented reality. So it is a mix of both virtual and augmented that results in a mixed. It is not to compare, actually.
Do you think one of this holds more potential than the other for development? Any of these holds more?
Yeah, so it depends on the application or the real-time need that real-time need that actually you would require it for. So if you just want a virtual space, like if you want to do a roller coaster based project, then that you can just do it on a VR screen. While if you want a, why now we are just moving to mixed reality is because, you know, the we want, like I said, you the street map thing that works. So that would be more helpful when it comes to a mixed reality based application rather than just a VR, or VR will definitely block. So it is out of space. So AR, you can just not interact with the environment. You need another feel that you are into it. So that is why it depends on every real-time based application.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
Is there any option to import objects from, say, CAD models or such objects into the A-frame?
For now, it supports GLTF alone, which is the 3D version of JPEG. So that is the only 3D model for now it is being used. On a later scale, we're trying to optimize it for all the supporting media also. For now, it is just GLTF.
And if someone is already using Unity to develop VR and AR apps, is there any reason for him to move to AR?
As I said earlier, you know, if you want it to be used by many people, if you they have seen so many glitches in a native-based application. So what if any of that fails? So that is why we moved to web, where it is free and easy and open to use.
See, whenever we do any kind of computational exercises like a similar one with AR, VR and all, we go native. Why? Because the performance is one of the most critical aspects when especially go to the mobile devices, right? So how is the performance metrics comparison of your browser-based AR, VR with what are we doing with the native, where we are right now?
Okay. So you're comparing with the native applications, right? So the performance, when I had tried, it has almost been the same. The only problem is with the internet. If you have a good internet connection, everything works well. And again, if you the problem, if you make it on a local, is that it has heavy load of JavaScripts. So if they are not loaded on the right constraint, then that becomes a problem. But if you have a good internet and try to import the JS online, then it gives you a very good, you know, actually compatibility. And the main thing is a memory space, you know, memory space when compared to the native applications, this is more feasible when you host it on any online platform. So that's how feasible it is.
You talk about the memory. Me see, all these objects are after all going to be allocated locally also, right? So memory consumption is going to be same or plus additional with additional stuff of browser.
Yes.
How the cost me? The rendering part is done by online service and then it is exported over here, or just I will get the code and then with AR, what are the A-frames, the plugins and all over here, it will get rendered.
Okay.
That's it. I mean, how?
Yeah. So there are two ways of doing this. So if you want, you can import all the JS files into your local server and then host it. Or otherwise, you can put it. You can just import it online. So the memory consumption is more feasible only if you import it from the online, you know, A-frame JS. So it is bit, you know, high. When I tried to do this for one of the games called 13K JS, like it's a game competition. So I faced the actual constraint where I had to bring it out to 13 KB and making it. So definitely when you host it online, it is very light. But if you try to import everything and download every JS and do it on a local space, definitely it becomes a bit high. But again, when compared to the native applications where it consumes more than 200 or 300 MB, this is more easy because when you go for, you know, 3D models itself, the consumption of the 3D models, that is the media files, are eventually high. Whereas JS and things that just, you know, 1 or 2 or 3 MB. But when you go for, you know, 3D based asset, it eventually increases. So that is why this, when comparative to the native ones, I feel this is more lighter.
I mean, I understand what he's asking. Like, WebGL can render it. If you're using WebGL, it's not technically JavaScript. You're asking it to render it in OpenGL. But my question is, if you've used Go or something like that, writing a simple server, say a transactions or FTP server in JavaScript, it'll just take 120 MB just to start the server. But in Go, it takes only 5 megabytes of memory. That's what I am concerned of. I mean, on a phone, like, phones are getting more powerful, yes, but they are supposed to run more background applications than actual computers on a lower power consumption. So how would JavaScript help there?
Yeah. Okay. So why we mainly went towards doing all this with JavaScript is because, you know, 3.js was very helpful in creating the experiences with the 3D asset which was already available. And as I said already, the minimal standard that it also helps for now is GLTF. So for now, we found that JS is the right thing because when it comes to web-based hosting and web-based support, and also these are not stable still because, you know, every version of browser is being updated on a very on every instance. So that is why the WebGL also supports the supportive that we take for WebGL background is also being, you know, is also not that supportive to experience these. So on a later run, maybe the ones that you consider will be maybe taken into account because all these are into still experiment phase. This is very clearly to only help one any of the layman to first understand what this technology is. So I'm when it comes to commercial ways, what Firefox does now is Firefox Mixed Reality has started their own browser into Vive and other Oculus and just these two or three devices where they try to build an inbuilt browser, and that's the only browser available within the VR headset. So for now, they're just focusing on how it can actually help. Maybe on a later run on these compatibilities, it would be taken into account.
It is almost certain that in future, these kind of technologies like AR, VR, and mixed reality will evolve more, and it will become more close to what we are experiencing presently. So are there any initiatives by Mozilla or some other company or maybe university for developing an ethical policy or ethical standards for using how to use these kind of technologies?
Yeah, so right now you can actually, I don't know any universities as in you're talking about, but for now it is more like open documents and stuff that have the guidelines to help you out with starting with. Actually, the more of the companies are moving towards, you know, bringing their product first into the market. So that is why there is no still proper guidelines of, you know, bringing it or developing it. So that is why A-Frame, as of now, has brought in that initiative of, if you go through even MDN docs or any of that, you can find out that there are a few guidelines that can actually help you to do some primary works. So it actually depends on us to develop and know more about it.
My question is not about having a documentation or something.
Yeah.
It's more about the implications of this technology. Like, are there any guidelines as to which, what is the limit of this AR and VR? The thing is that after deploying or after making a successful global deployment of these kind of technologies, there is no point in going after ethics because at least some of the products will be open source. In machine learning, I hope you have heard about deep fakes, the kind of technology that is used to make sexual content by using deep learning. So those kind of implications are happening in the world. And are there any guidelines that you guys are following in order to make sure that this is not happening using this technology?
Since it is, I don't know whether it's fortunate or unfortunate, it is an open source, so we cannot stop anyone from doing this or violating the terms. I mean, it is not violation of the terms, but you know, there is no proper constraint to which they can do the application to. You can just use the component or use any of the features into it and embed it. But as of now, maybe you can go through the rights or the you know, rules being given in the A-frame that gives you a few terms of, you know, what it actually it is. But for now, most of the evolving stuff, it's difficult to constrain people or developers to stop down to some point, because no one knows at what time any new thing may come. So it is not good to also stop them from trying anything out. So we find out, see, without doing something bad, we don't know it is bad. So that is why for now there are not much standards or anything being brought for. But maybe if we see that there are so many you know, things that are harmful or anything of that such kind, then you can actually, it is good in Mozilla that you have even advocacy policies where you can directly approach and tell, you know, this is not good for the world or it is not good. So it can be considered. It depends on, you know, as the number of users start to increase over this. There is less of awareness, as I've seen. So first an awareness to be made and then to be thought over these stuff.
Anyone else?
In this world of technological addiction, don't you think in the future with more VR and AR and mixed reality stuff, it might cause people to get more lost in the virtual world than from the real?
May cause?
People to get lost in the virtual world, like more interaction with virtual stuff than what's happening in reality.
Okay, so every technology is like that. So to have a pro and a con. So before we started to use mobile phones, we were not addicted to it. Once we saw the comfort, we started to get addicted. It is of the same way. But that is why we say on what way you do the application for, what for you using that application, and if it is actually solving the problem. If you go for entertainment, of course, you know, it is going to be of great addiction. So again, it comes to us. It is the users who should know the limitless boundaries and be careful about it.
Anyone else? When you were explaining about the solar system, right? You told that for adding rings, you just add a function called
Torus.
Yeah, Torus. So my question is, I've used Unity also. So in Unity also, in that GUI application, you have so many buttons. You click the buttons and everything comes to any way you want. So what my question was, coming to the open source society, these functions which we use, which we just simply click and it comes, are those functions open source? Or is the design and algorithm of that function something that we can find and we can take in and we can develop on that? So how does all this relate to the open source world?
You mean the function in Unity is open source or?
No, not the function. Like if you, the movement, translation, rotation, all those things are something that you make. But things such as rigid body, or how do you add the physics into the whole thing? All those things are simply buttons in the, yeah. So are those also, can we make changes to that according to our liking?
Yes, it's absolutely yes when it comes to open source. Like if you use an A-frame, you can definitely define, that is why I was repeatedly saying that the components which already exist, also you can take them out and do some tweaks on it and use them. So definitely when it is in open source, you can do that of your own way you want it.